And it's because somewhere along the line, they allowed trash to get on that well. And instead of taking the time to fix themselves, they talk about everybody else. You can get quiet. Becky gets quiet all the time when I preach to her. I'm used to it. But trash gets on that well. And it blocks up and it binds the power of God. I remember Mama, we lived up on Campbell's Creek, and I remember Daddy, he worked up in the coal mines at the time. We lived in a little single wide trailer there, and Mama put up this Christmas tree, and she put this Christmas tree up, and we put them lights all the way around, and we plug that thing in, and wasn't one blessed light come on that tree. And she'd say, "All right, you and Brian get to work. Out of one of them 100,003,054 lights on that tree, I need you to find the one bad bulb." And boy, me and Brian go all the way down that tree trying to find the bad bulb. And when we'd find the bad bulb, boop, the whole tree light up. Do you know the church works like that? Oh yeah, oh yeah. The Holy Ghost begins to move around, and God begins to do a work in this service, and God begins to move, and then sooner or later, God will find it. Bad bulb. How many churches do not experience revival because of one bad bulb? I don't ever want to hinder the Holy Ghost. You say, what hinders the bitterness, anger, unforgiveness, gossip, backbiting, fornication? I'm telling you, all of those things are things that block and hinder and block the Holy Ghost of God from doing what He wants to do. I don't ever want to be a bad bulb. But that trash gets on that well, and it blocks and binds the blessing of God. Let me ask you a question. When's the last time your well sprung up into everlasting? When's the last time that she's driving down the road, or boy, when's the last time you sat in a service and just got so tore up over the fact that you can't go to hell? When's the last time that, boy, you sat there and the power of God began to drip down your heart and you recognized how good God was to you? Boys, Jesse began to sing tonight, "I just want to thank you, Lord. I looked down there at my little 18-month-old boy. I looked over here at my daddy and my mama and my friends, all I'm telling you," and that well stirred up inside of me about how good and how wonderful God's been to me. I'm telling you, every now and then you ought to have a fit on how good God's been to you in your life. That well, let me say this, that well is the most important and the most vital thing that you need to protect. The Word of God says the joy of the Lord is our strength. Therefore, the joy of the Lord comes from that well. And if that well is not stirred, then you don't have any strength. How's your well doing tonight? A year, two, three ago, right after I was here for the last winter revival, I don't know, 2 years ago maybe, I went from there, and just a few months after that, I went to a little church in Liberty, South Carolina. It was probably the size of this church with a balcony, but inside that church, there was probably maybe 100 people sitting inside that little building. Me and Becky went inside that building, and all the friends that I had in that area said, "Brother CT, it's going to be you and Jesus at that meeting. That place is pretty cold. You're going to have a time." But I'm just as called to go there as I am here. I went there, and boy, I acted like it was the Jubilee time. I preach the same way everywhere I go. I just got in there, and boy, the power of God began to flow in that place. Sunday morning, the altars filled up. Sunday night, the altars filled up. I was preaching around the same vein as I am here tonight. Preach about being right with God, being right with your brethren, getting things right, being a soul. I just preached on the same vein. Every single altars just pile up. Monday night I went back, and boy, people would stand up and testify. They was getting right on the altar. God began to move inside that little place. Yeah. Tuesday night I got up and preached, and the power of God fell again, and I didn't know what to do. I'm talking about just that 100 people just getting things right with God and cleaning up around the church.
Good.
I woke up Wednesday morning, and I was reading my Bible, doing my morning devotions, and the Holy Ghost spoke to my heart as only He can. And He said, I'm not done here. I said, Lord, this is a Sunday through Wednesday meeting. I said, I'm just the evangelist. I'm not the pastor. I don't make those decisions. And boy, God broke my heart. He put it in my heart, said, I want you to stay here. I'm not done in this city yet. I'm not finished what I'm doing yet. I said, God, I'm just the evangelist. I'm not going to manipulate this situation. I said, God, if you'll tell that pastor, I said, I'll cancel as many meetings as you need me to.
Yeah,
I'll stay here as long as you want me to. I want to see revival in my day.
Yeah.
Hung up the phone. I spoke with Brother Ralph. I spoke with several pastors that I put great confidence in. I told him what I was doing. I said, I'm not going to manipulate this. I said, I'm going to stay quiet. If he doesn't say anything, I'll go home tonight. But this is what God has put on my heart. Right after I got off the phone, that pastor called me. He said, Brother CT, he said, I haven't slept all night. God wants this meeting to keep on going. You got to stay. I said, preacher, I started crying uncontrollably. I said, you're not going to believe this. And I told him word for word what I'd told God. That Wednesday night, we walked back in that church, and we didn't tell the people till after service, but the same power of God fell on the side of that thing. And as the pastor got up and said, we're going to keep going, the people stood up and began to applaud, and they said, yes, we've been praying for that. And God not only worked in my heart and his heart, but God was working in their heart. And Thursday night, we came back, and I preached around the same thing. And boy, people began to get up from this side in the middle of the service and go to that side and say, I said this about you, and I never should have said that. I'm sorry. Would you please forgive me? I watch people go from the back with a bitter heart, go up to the pastor and ask for apology. One by one by one, people begin to get the trash off of their well.
Amen.
Many times I'd be right in the middle of preaching the word. I'd be right in the middle of preaching the word of God. I've seen people under Holy Ghost conviction stand up and get their cell phone and walk out the back door and call a daddy that they hadn't talked to in 10 years and say, Daddy, I'm sorry for what I did. I want to reconcile this difference that we. And little by little, the Holy Ghost of God began to walk around that church and pick up trash off of people's heart, little by little by little. We went to church Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. He said, we're going to come back and go another week. We'll just go Monday through Wednesday. Surely that'll be all it is. I said, preacher, whatever. I told God I'd stay as long as he wants to. Monday night we come back, 100 people turned into 200 people. People started getting the word that God was doing something around there. And boy, they started coming in week number two. People started getting born again by the power of God. I think there was 30 some people in week number two got born again by the power of God. Still people getting things right. One night, in week number three, there was a woman came up, and boy, she was under conviction, and she said, Brother CT, I've got to get saved. I said, ma'am, who are you? Where are you from? She said, I drive a school bus in this town. She said, there are two boys, the worst boys on the bus. She said, today, I was driving my route, and the two worst, nastiest mouth boys in the bus route, another boy started cussing, and they went back there to him and said, if you cuss again, you're going to have problems with us. She said she looked at them boys and said, how do you have a right to tell them boys not to cuss when y'all cuss more than anybody? Said that oldest 11th grade boy looked at her and said, ma'am, I used to cuss. Said, but Jesus saved me down at that revival. And she said, he said, I'm a brand new person now. She walked down there on that altar. She said, if it was that real to them, it's got to be real for me. And she gave her life to Jesus Christ on that altar. Woo! And I could tell you stories. There was at least four or five marriages that have been divorced that God put back together. I've seen rebellious teenagers that were giving their lives into sin, fornication, and drugs. I watched them get right with God. I watched them get right with their mama and their daddy as the power of Almighty God rested and nestled in that little town.
Yeah.
Week number four, 40 or 50 got saved. Week number five, same thing. Now that 100 group of people is 600 and 700 people every single night. By week number six, I'm telling you, these boys was there. Give me my witness. People were lined up against the wall. The balcony was slapped full. The choir was full. Many times as Brother Jared came one night or two, we was sitting there singing, "My name is in the book of life. Oh, bless the name of Jesus." And as we sit there, we had just sang the first song, brother. And then the first song, a boy walked down the front aisle under Holy Ghost conviction. Jared just got there, and the boy had tears flowing down his face, and he looked at Jared and said, "Where do I got to do to get saved?"
Yeah.
Jared started crying. He said, "This is real."
Yeah.
I'm talking about before the service would even start, there was a cloud in that church. There was a power of God, an old-fashioned Holy Ghost. You hear me? I still believe in the power of the Holy Ghost. It settled in that church, and men got saved. Women got saved. Religious folks got saved as the power of Almighty God fell in that place.
Amen.
How many weeks do we go? 8 weeks. Think it was the biggest night. There was over 800 people jammed inside that little building. 102 people got born again in 8 weeks.
Amen.
To this day, I still go back four times a year and hold big rallies, and there'll be over 1,500 teenagers packed in those buildings. All based out of what God did in that revival. I'll never get over what God did. But you want to know where it started? It started with 100 people saying, "God, I don't want to carry this bitterness no more. God, I can't deal with this unforgiveness no more. God, please get it off of me. God, my kids are going to hell. They need to be saved. God, you're the only hope for them. God, please send the power of God." And as they picked up that trash, that well started springing again. What's it worth for you to have your well spring back again? There's some of you in here, it may have been 20 years ago that you remember the last time you sat at a church camp or at a camp meeting. It could have been 20 years ago when you heard Mays Jackson preach in a church around here, and the power of God was so real in your life. But now you sit there and you're worried about what time we're going to get out tonight. You're worried about, well, the sound was a little too loud. You're worried about everything that's insignificant. And you're missing what God is trying to do. In this area, I can't think of a greater need for revival. Drugs are worse here than anywhere I've ever seen. We're seeing marriages split apart left and right. We're seeing teenagers getting strung out on drugs left and right. We're seeing mamas and daddies' hearts broken by sin left and right. And God has set up camp here in Hurricane, West Virginia, because God, with everything He is, wants to send a Holy Ghost-filled revival to this city. It's not fictionary. It's not a fairy tale. But literally, God wants to save this entire town. God wants to turn it upside down. I'm telling you, there is a new generation rising up, and if we don't get a hold of God, they'll never see the glory. It's time for somebody to go back and get a hold of God and say, "God, we've got to have the power of God back in our churches." Tradition isn't working. What your great grandpa did ain't working in this generation. Don't get me wrong, I'm not a compromiser. I'm going to stick by the truths of that word of God. But just because grandpa did something don't mean we got to keep doing it. And listen to me, we're losing a new generation because we've lost that power